By 1986, nobody accused Christopher Weaver of being an underachiever. After working on high-end technologies in the labs of MIT, he went on to both NBC and ABC before becoming the chief engineer to the House Subcommittee on Communications. What was left to do but found his own company? So he started Media Technologies. But because he clearly hadn't done enough with his life yet, he started another company not long after. This time, he wanted to see if the PC gaming market was ready to make the next technological leap into better, more realistic games. He was in Bethesda, Maryland at the time, so he thought long and hard, and then named his company Bethesda Softworks. Ironically, while their first few years were filled with sports titles, over the years they would become defined by some of the most sprawling fantasy epics in gaming history, covering everything from medieval magic to the radioactive future. In the process, they have expanded and acquired some of the most storied developers in the world to emerge as one of the most powerful forces in gaming today. Under Weaver's supervision, the first game from the new studio was a football game, but one that would make use of Weaver's scientific background. Up to that time, sports games just used statistical models to determine whether, for example, a receiver could complete a pass. By contrast, Bethesda's self-published Gridiron would simulate actual physics, including mass and velocity, to determine how far the ball would go. Of course, since computers weren't very powerful in the mid-80s, the trade-off for modeling real-time physics was dirt-simple graphics. Players were represented by dots. Still, it was impressive enough to gain some attention, and was considered a success for the young startup. So good was their buzz that they got a call from one of the rising superstars in the industry. Electronic Arts was trying to break into the sports world big time, and they'd already signed up legendary commentator John Madden to lend his name to the new title. Now, EA wanted Weaver's physics tech in the very first John Madden football. As a part of the deal, EA would also publish new Gridiron games, so Bethesda happily agreed. Unfortunately, after EA had incorporated Bethesda's physics into their engine, they suddenly lost interest in releasing another competing football series. In other words, Gridiron was left out to dry. Feeling betrayed, Bethesda sued the publisher for $7 million. While the result of this suit was never publicly disclosed, what is known is that Bethesda never worked with EA again, and Madden went on to be one of the single most profitable video game franchises in history. So it goes. In the meantime, Bethesda continued with the sports genre with Wayne Gretzky Hockey and a sequel. They also started branching out into licensed territory. To start, in 1990, they made the first video game based on a tiny independent film that was gaining a cult following, The Terminator. Aside from being the future cyborg's first game, it was also Bethesda's first DOS game. The title allowed the player to shoot people from a first-person perspective, a very early entrant into the genre that Doom would conquer 3 years later. Afterwards came a number of licensed games, including Home Alone and Where's Waldo, which were published by THQ. Other than these games, the ambitious Bethesda chose to self-publish all their work, including a slew of new Terminator titles. Also in 1990, Bethesda left Bethesda. The company moved from their namesake city and went next door to Rockville, Maryland. But the studio chose to keep its name anyway. But amidst all the licensed and sports titles, Bethesda wanted to try and make something of their own. Ironically, most of Bethesda's staff were never really interested in sports to begin with. They'd rather be playing Dungeons & Dragons or the computer game Ultima Underworld. So when they began their new venture, they combined their knowledge of making competitive sports titles with their interest in fantasy. Arena was going to be a gladiator combat game in which the player would slowly build up a team to tour the world's stadiums in battles to the death. But as the game progressed, they decided it needed more context, so they threw in a story. And to flesh out the game a bit, they threw in some side quests you could do between tournaments. Before they knew it, the story and the side quests started getting more in-depth and more fun to play. Eventually, the tournament was dropped altogether, and almost by accident, Bethesda had a first-person RPG on its hands. And it was a whopper. The world of Arena was absolutely gigantic, one of the biggest ever put in a video game. Of course, the Bethesda team cheated a bit. While each city in the game was handcrafted by the designers, the landscapes around the cities were randomly generated. This meant that every time a player walked outside a city, he would discover an entirely new set of pathways and dungeons to explore. Items, monsters, and encounters would always be new and different, without the designers having to custom build it all. What this meant was that even though the game wasn't wildly different from the Ultima series, it painted its canvas on a grander scale. Given all that, it was clear to the team that the original name, Arena, didn't fit anymore. Unfortunately, Bethesda had already done quite a bit of marketing for the game under that title. As a compromise, the game was renamed to The Elder Scrolls Arena, the idea being that the world was so full of danger, the entire place was one big arena. But the name wouldn't be the only marketing promise to become a problem. Bethesda had promised retailers that the game would be ready by Christmas 1993. It wasn't. Sadly, when the game finally did hit shelves in March 1994, it was initially met by slow sales. Gamers found that it wasn't the medieval gladiator game that they'd been promised, and worse, the opening dungeon was so brutally difficult that many gamers never made it to the outside world. However, those players that did make it outside found one of the richest, most satisfying RPGs ever produced. The gigantic world, fantastic art, and solid story made for an adventure that a player could sink dozens of hours into with no end in sight. And everybody could play it their own way. A player could stick to the story, or just wander around, charge right into the enemy, or sneak around him, amass huge wealth, or live as a hermit. Whichever fantasy a player had always wanted to act out, Arena could provide. The strong word of mouth kept the game alive, and in the end, the title became an underground sensation. To their own surprise, the Elder Scrolls franchise looked like it might have a future after all. Since this was their first homegrown franchise, and the one the team were most proud of, it was a fantastic turn of events. Incidentally, though Arena was primarily sold on floppy disk, the game was also released onto CD-ROM. Helping test the CD version for bugs was Bethesda's newest hire, a young wannabe game maker named Todd Howard.
Yeah, I started in 94, so it was a small game development studio. Maybe there was 25 people there. The first project I did was actually NCAA basketball. I came in, there was an outside developer making it, and it was work with them and get this out in 3 months. So the game ended up as you'd expect. In those days, again, there's 20-some developers. Everybody does everything. So the CD-ROM version of Arena was a thing I was given to help shepherd along. So I did a lot, you know, I viewed myself as the main QA resource as well. I played it like mad over and over and over again.
While another team at Bethesda went off and finished the cyberspace combat game Delta V, Howard went on to lead production on the company's newest Terminator game, Future Shock. This was the first title to use Bethesda's home-built engine, called X-Engine. Releasing in 1995, it was one of the first true 3D polygon engines in the industry, a technique that would be popularized a year later by id Software's Quake. Howard went on to produce Future Shock's expansion pack, which evolved into the full sequel, Skynet, in 1996.
And looking back, I'd only been there 3-4 months, and here I'm the, you know, okay, you're in charge of this game. I don't know how that happened. It seems I was very eager, and but again, these were small teams and small, probably talking about like 8 people, and I jumped in and was managing the project and started doing a lot of level design. So I probably end up built half the levels in that game myself.
But good as the Terminator had been to the company, the Elder Scrolls was their crown jewel. Now armed with their own engine as well, the company was ready to make the biggest and most ambitious games in their history. Little did they know that their passion projects would nearly sink the studio for good. When Christopher Weaver founded his own video game company in Bethesda, Maryland, he started off by making a number of sports games. Bethesda Softworks' Gridiron was the first football game to ever simulate real-world physics, a feature that has been emulated by the genre ever since. Moving on into licensed territory, Bethesda next made the first games based on The Terminator. At last, they turned to making their own original content. To their own surprise, their gladiator combat game Arena quickly evolved into a first-person RPG, set in one of the largest worlds ever constructed for a video game.
And it just kept expanding. It kept adding features, and eventually, this is going to be a big role-playing game, and the world of Tamriel was the world that the guys had created for their own, you know, D&D sessions. That was the world they were playing in.
Strong word of mouth propelled the Elder Scrolls into a cult hit, and Bethesda finally had a franchise to call their own. After building their own 3D engine, they got to work on a sequel that would be even more grandiose than its ambitious predecessor. Beyond that, they were also planning to expand the Elder Scrolls into a broader franchise. But they would find that their ambitions had gotten away from them, and as the 90s came to a close, Bethesda looked like it was headed for oblivion. Bethesda self-published The Elder Scrolls II Daggerfall in August 1996. The team had taken everything about the first game that audiences loved and massively expanded on it.
I did grieve for him, but his spirit does not rest. With a spectral army, he haunts his former kingdom, crying for revenge.
The game world covered an area the size of Britain, with thousands of towns and hundreds of thousands of NPCs. To help fill out this huge world, the small team, including quest designer Todd Howard, created an algorithm to randomly generate environments, dungeons, items, and monsters. The end result was a game that a player could sink dozens or even hundreds of hours into without ever seeing it all. The game's story was also taken further than ever before. This time, instead of a directed quest line, it was a sprawling, non-linear campaign that had six different possible endings. Of course, in true Elder Scrolls fashion, a player could always just ignore the main quest to go do one of the hundreds of side quests, or just explore the world, or raid dungeons, or anything else in a world that seemed to have no limits. And as the player did so, she would discover that the abilities she was using were getting more powerful. Daggerfall debuted a brand new leveling system. Instead of the typical format of gaining experience points and then spending those points on specific abilities, Daggerfall instead automatically leveled up whatever the player was using. It was simple, intuitive, and natural, and became a standout feature of the series going forward. However, the game also had its share of problems. While its massive scale was impressive, it was also hard to fine-tune.
Daggerfall was a hard project, yeah, and a very troubled one in terms of we bit off more than we could chew in a big way. It's a very buggy game. It was a struggle for the company financially, but it was a successful game, right? It sold really well, and people took to it. They really gave us the benefit of the doubt. I mean, I think we're lucky.
In the end, based on the good name of the franchise and Daggerfall's own strong points, the game went on to be the company's biggest success to date. The Elder Scrolls was now clearly Bethesda's flagship franchise. So the company now bet its future on the fantasy world of Tamriel. After Daggerfall, not only did The Elder Scrolls III formally go into production, but two other Elder Scrolls games as well. On top of that, more sports titles for bowling and drag racing were on the way, in addition to the science fiction game 10th Planet for the makers of the film Independence Day. In other words, Bethesda's ambitions got away from them, and quality started to suffer. In November 1997, the newest Elder Scrolls game released, and it was a completely different beast from the earlier titles. An Elder Scrolls legend, Battlespire, was a smaller scale adventure focused on combat. The thinking was that the coolest part of the series was fighting monsters, so making a straight action game with linear levels would be more fun and appeal to more people. Also, since the release of Blizzard Entertainment's Diablo a year earlier, it was clear that the action RPG genre had a market. But Battlespire still featured a solid story, and its dialogue was considered better than even Daggerfall. Since the game was more focused, the team could afford to handcraft the entire world. No more randomly generated environments. Everything from the wall decorations to the rocks would be intentionally placed. This allowed the game to have a more purposeful design and a more artistic aesthetic. On top of all of that, Battlespire also had multiplayer for the first time in the series, allowing for both co-op play and competitive combat. In other words, the game had an incredible feature set, and in theory should have been the best game Bethesda had ever produced. Unfortunately, since the development team was split between Battlespire and all the other games Bethesda was working on, they didn't have time to polish everything. So when Battlespire hit store shelves, its genuinely good aspects were overshadowed by rampant bugs. While the fans had put up with Daggerfall's problems, they refused to do so a second time. Burn Gamer steered clear of the title, and Battlespire was not a success. The cracks in the company were starting to show. Money was running dry. The Elder Scrolls III was put on hold, and the 10th Planet was canceled for reasons never disclosed. Still, the company did have another Elder Scrolls game coming out, and it was hoped that this game would prove the model that Battlespire had failed at. The Elder Scrolls Adventures, Redguard, would also be an action game in a smaller world. Redguard also introduced puzzles into the mix. But though it once again received praise for a fun story and a great setting, it was faulted for clunky controls, lame graphics, and more bugs. To top things off, it was a DOS game. that released in 1998, well after DOS had been replaced by Windows. It was another commercial failure. But at the same time, it was the first Elder Scrolls game made under the direction of Todd Howard.
Redguard was not a successful game for the company. And my takeaway from that was, we missed some technology windows, and we were a bit conservative in what the game was. It was a very kind of, you know, narrow game. When people wanted from us the, you know, big role-playing, the Elder Scrolls, and Morrowind had been put on the back burner. When I talked about us spreading ourselves thin and getting in financial trouble, that's when the company became ZeniMax in 99.
By this point, Bethesda had driven itself into quicksand. Close to bankruptcy, the development team had shrunk to about 6 people. Then, out of nowhere, ZeniMax Media offered to buy the company and bail them out of their financial difficulties. Therefore, ZeniMax, which was co-founded by Christopher Weaver, acquired Media Technologies, which was founded by Christopher Weaver, which owned Bethesda Softworks, which was founded by Christopher Weaver. What a coincidence. The influx of cash helped the studio for the immediate future, but if they didn't release another big seller soon, they would go under for good. You might think that the bruised Bethesda would play it safe at this point, but instead, they decided to expand their business model. In 1999, they for the first time published a game made by somebody else, Zero Critical, a 3D point-and-click adventure from Istvan Pelli Productions. Sadly, by 1999, the adventure genre was dead in the water, and the game went nowhere. The next year saw another drag racing game that, again, didn't lift the sagging company. And the bad news was about to get a lot worse. In late 2001, Weaver was ousted from ZeniMax by his own partners. Weaver later sued them, claiming that his partners had bought his strong brands and then gotten rid of him. However, the case was not deemed worthy of going to court since he had illegally searched his former partner's emails for information. It was an unhappy end for Weaver, but as he still owned one-third of the company, things weren't all bad. The company he left, however, was in dire straits. Years since their last successful title, they needed to go big or go home. So in a last desperate gamble, they bet the whole company on Howard and his next Elder Scrolls game, the full sequel that had been on hold for years. It quickly became the biggest and most expensive project in the history of the company. If it flopped, it would be the end of Bethesda. But if, by some miracle, it actually sold, and sold well, it might just single-handedly save the company.
By the late 1990s, publisher and developer Bethesda Softworks was nearly out of cash. Despite finding success with their Elder Scrolls series of fantasy role-playing games, the studio's faith in the franchise proved too strong for their own good. While Daggerfall had been a success, its many bugs and general lack of polish turned off many fans. So when Bethesda tried to release a number of smaller, linear action titles that still had the same unfinished feel, gamers just ignored them. Combined with the canceled project, The Tenth Planet, and their unremarkable first attempt to publish an external game, and Bethesda soon found itself in deep financial trouble. To make matters worse, the company's founder, Christopher Weaver, was ousted from his other company, ZeniMax Media, once it acquired Bethesda. Starved of cash, Bethesda's development team had atrophied down to 6 people. There was no way the studio was going to survive, unless they went all in on the biggest game they could possibly make, one so massive, polished, and perfected that nothing else on the market could even come close to it. They needed to burst back on the scene with a generation-defining title, or they would just fade away forever. Fortunately for them, and for gamers everywhere, the game they crafted was and is one of the single finest interactive experiences ever produced. The Elder Scrolls III was originally started just after the second game, Daggerfall, but was put on hold to concentrate on the smaller Elder Scrolls titles. Aside from that, to really push the boundaries from where Daggerfall had gone, they knew they would have to give technology some time to catch up to their vision. The game was picked up again after The Elder Scrolls Adventure Redguard released in 1998, initially slated for a holiday 1999 release. But that barely gave the development team any time to make it, and since they were so small now anyway, that was a recipe for disaster. The game's director was Todd Howard, the man behind Redguard, who had also worked on the earlier Elder Scrolls. He knew that making another little game would just kill the company. taking bold action, he went to his executives and told them they need to give him a massive budget to grow his tiny team and produce a gigantic game.
So when Redguard came out, it was immediately, we are going to do, you know, I want to do more. We're going to do Morrowind. And we are going to make it the biggest, craziest game we can. Because otherwise, we're not going to. That's not why we're here. We're here to make a game like this. And the team then was, maybe there were 6 or 7 people left in development. And, you know, built from there. And that's kind of the modern genesis of Bethesda.
Amazingly, he got what he asked for. ZeniMax gambled all in on The Elder Scrolls III and its director to single-handedly turn the studio around. Howard had permission to do whatever he wanted. Now all he had to do was live up to their trust. At the outset, Howard and his growing team decided that they needed to reimagine the game's technology from the ground up. Bethesda's homebrewed engine, called X-Engine, had been unveiled back in 1995, and by Redguard was looking just plain bad. There was no way they could rely on that engine for their big comeback, but they didn't have the resources to build a new one anymore. So they licensed an outside engine called Netimmerse, later called Gamebryo, which was both graphically astounding and could manage huge draw distances. But even with the new tech, it was going to be a chore just to build the whole world. Redguard had taught the team that handcrafting the game space was much better than randomly generating environments. But to craft something on the scale of an entire country, as The Elder Scrolls III intended to be, the crew would need a fantastic instrument to make it with. Unlike the engine, Bethesda chose to make this itself, and it was coded by no less than the director himself.
At the time, I was playing with a lot of mod stuff for various games. I remember Myth was really a game I loved. They had a lot of this plug-in architecture where you could download stuff, put it in, it would change the game. But also, Morrowind was start of that project, and how are we even going to make this game? And it came, well, we need, if we have a big tool that allows us to build it, that's where, you know, that's going to make the difference. So I actually started coding again, and I started coding the original construction set. And I was inspired by the Apple II Stuart Smith's Adventure construction set. I still have it.
Still, even with their own construction set in hand, their reach exceeded their grasp. They had chosen to set their story in the country of Morrowind in the franchise's story world, and it proved to be too big. Eventually, they constricted the game to the country's subcontinent, but even this was 10 square miles. 10 square miles that they were going to hand-design every square inch of themselves. It was still an awe-inspiring challenge and a logistical nightmare. But Bethesda believed they could do it and pressed ahead with the Herculean task. As time passed, unbelievably, the game began to take shape, and it was looking like everything they hoped it could be, a huge, beautiful world that allowed the player to do anything he wanted. But as if they didn't already have enough to worry about, in 2000, the team suddenly heard about a new opportunity. Microsoft had announced that it was entering the home console market with a powerful system that critically had its own hard drive. No console had ever come with one before. This new Xbox system, therefore, would have enough memory to save all the different permutations the gamer could put the world through, while also having the graphical horsepower to make it look good. They whipped up a demo for the game and showed it to Microsoft. It was perfect timing. The Xbox team knew that they needed top-notch games to help sell their system, and so far they didn't have any RPGs. When Bethesda pitched Morrowind, Microsoft immediately agreed that it should be a launch title for their system. It was done. The already taxed Bethesda team would now be making a multi-platform game. It helped that the Xbox architecture was similar to a Windows PC, making the transition relatively easy. But even for all of that, in the end, the team had to push the game from its November 2001 release, and therefore, missed the Xbox launch. But in May 2002, The Elder Scrolls III Morrowind finally released for the PC, published by Bethesda, with some help from Ubisoft. And it was a masterpiece. Morrowind was every bit the sprawling epic Bethesda had set out to make back when they only had 6 developers. The subcontinent the player landed on was not only the promised 10 square miles, but so incredibly varied that just exploring the world was fun by itself. The game's various factions each had their own architecture, culture, and style of dress. It had everything from coastal fishing villages, to epic castles, to wizards' towers, to ashen volcanoes. Astoundingly, each one of the thousands of books in the game could be picked up and read. The player might find a novel, a history textbook, or political treaties. The main quest was enormous, but was only a fraction of all the quests available to the player. He could join a guild, rise through the ranks, or then join a competing guild. He could play as a powerful warrior, a mighty mage, or a stealthy assassin. And no matter what happened, the game would never end. There was always something else to do, someone else to meet, and somewhere else to explore. All in a beautifully realized world with gorgeous art and composer Jeremy Soule's pitch-perfect score. And that was just May. In June, Morrowind came to the Xbox as well. Even months after the launch of the console, Morrowind was still the system's first RPG. And gamers and critics alike were shocked to discover that nothing had been sacrificed to get it onto the console. It was the exact same stellar experience mapped onto thumbsticks. Morrowind quickly became a must-have title for the Xbox and one of the console's earliest hits. By 2003, it was the second best-selling game on the system, behind only Halo itself. And by 2004, Morrowind had sold 1 million units on the Xbox alone. And the good news wasn't limited to sales. The game won enough accolades to re-release in a Game of the Year edition in 2003. As if that wasn't enough, on the PC side, Morrowind had shipped with the finished version of the Elder Scrolls construction set that Howard had started at the beginning of the project. It was one of the most complete tools ever given to the modding community and allowed them to create anything they wanted within the engine. The game's fanbase continued to make mods for Morrowind to this day, giving the game an incredible longevity and endless new experiences to try out. To be fair, the game did have its issues, most notably the series' trademark bugs at launch. Still, they weren't nearly as bad as in earlier Scrolls, and they certainly didn't outweigh the game's overall excellence. At the end of the day, The Elder Scrolls III Morrowind achieved everything it set off to do, and then some. On the verge of bankruptcy after Redguard, after Morrowind, Bethesda was one of the biggest RPG developers in the world. Their gamble to bet it all on Howard's vision had paid off with dividends. Naturally, Bethesda Softworks development team quickly began work on The Elder Scrolls IV. But as they did so, they would no longer be known as Bethesda Softworks development team. They would be getting their own name. From then on, they were Bethesda Game Studios. Bethesda Softworks was now the publishing arm of the company. So as the Softworks division began a slow process of becoming a serious publisher in the industry, the Game Studios division began the monumental task of making 10 square miles look small.
Despite a promising beginning, the ambitious publisher and developer Bethesda Softworks soon found itself overextended. They had made a cult hit with the first game of their Elder Scrolls franchise, Arena. Understandably, they wanted to capitalize on their success. So they made a number of Elder Scrolls games right in a row, and as it turned out, splitting their concentration between so many projects made their efforts feel undercooked. Rampant bugs, poor graphics, and a limited scope made these games commercial flops. Knowing that playing it safe would just sink the company, Bethesda instead decided to put everything into one last Elder Scrolls game that would be as big, as fun, and as polished as they could possibly make it. And while the resulting Elder Scrolls III Morrowind still had its fair share of bugs, it was so good on the whole that it became a smash hit on both the PC and the Xbox.
I think it's what the audience wanted, and I think it's what we wanted as well. It's both of those things. It was the game that we wanted to play, and we wanted to prove that we still had that game in us. I think if that game wasn't successful, we probably wouldn't be here.
All of a sudden, Bethesda was on solid ground again, and a rising star of the gaming world. But while Morrowind had given them a lot of experience points, it would be their next game that leveled them up to the big leagues. Immediately after Morrowind released, the Bethesda development team, now called Bethesda Game Studios, got to work on a sequel. Team lead Todd Howard successfully argued that they should take their time with the sequel, instead of just rushing it out the door. After all, the rush strategy had nearly killed the company last time. Plus, this way they could make a true next-gen title with HD graphics, which could release onto the seventh generation of consoles. The only problem was those consoles hadn't even been invented yet. Bethesda would have to guess how much memory and horsepower those systems would have, code to that guess, and then change it once the actual system specs were announced. Not ideal working conditions. In the meantime, the company's other half, Bethesda Softworks, continued publishing projects from outside studios. They'd started doing this in the late 90s with games like Zero Critical, Magic and Mayhem, and Sea Dogs. The added recognition from Morrowind allowed them to push their third-party titles further, most notably by turning Sea Dogs 2 into the official Pirates of the Caribbean movie tie-in. Morrowind's good name also convinced Bethesda that the Elder Scrolls franchise had strong commercial value. However, they agreed with Howard that the game studio's team should stay focused on one big game. Thus, Bethesda Softworks tapped outside parties to create the Elder Scrolls Travels series, which spawned a number of games for mobile phones and Nokia's ill-fated Engage. Then in 2004, Bethesda heard about a new opportunity. Late the previous year, former industry powerhouse Interplay Entertainment had shut down its development studio after running out of cash. However, a number of their gaming IPs were still valuable, including Earthworm Jim and Baldur's Gate. And many at Bethesda had been huge fans of the Fallout series of RPGs. Now all these properties were up for licensing. So Bethesda reached out to them and acquired a license to make the next Fallout game. However, since the game studio's team was still rolling on the next Elder Scrolls, for the time being, Fallout was put on the back burner. In the meantime, another team in the game studio's division were making new entrants into Bethesda's long-running drag racing series, which released in 2004 and 2006. As it happened, this would be the last time Bethesda ever split its staff. From then on, everybody would work together under Howard's direction. But there was only one game that fans were waiting for. In March 2006, Bethesda Game Studios finished The Elder Scrolls IV Oblivion for the Xbox 360 and PC, published by Bethesda Softworks with some help from 2K Games. Just like Morrowind before it, it was originally meant to launch alongside Microsoft's newest console, this time the Xbox 360 in November 2005. However, just like Morrowind before it, Oblivion was delayed for 6 months to make sure everything was as polished as it could be. And just like Morrowind before it, it was still the first RPG available on the system. And it was as massive as fans had come to expect. However, with a game world fully 16 square miles at HD quality, Bethesda had to fall back a bit on randomly generated content. It wasn't ideal since the team preferred designing everything by hand, but in this case, it was necessary. Fortunately for gamers, it all looked gorgeous with an updated engine and some of the best-looking environments ever put in a game. In addition, Oblivion featured a revamped AI for all the inhabitants of the world. The Radiant system gave each NPC her own schedule and daily routine, giving each city a living feel that few other games had attempted. Not all of this worked perfectly, as Oblivion did showcase Bethesda's signature bugs yet again. Still, a few glitches in such a world could be overlooked. For Oblivion, Bethesda also went the extra mile and had each NPC speak every line of dialogue, as opposed to the pages of text that earlier games had. This required a massive investment in voice actors, but instead of shying away, they went all the way and hired some well-known Hollywood talent such as Sir Patrick Stewart and Sean Bean.
I was born 87 years ago. For 65 years, I've ruled as Tamriel's emperor. But for all these years, I've never been the ruler of my own dreams.
The protagonist, however, remained silent throughout. Otherwise, it was the same stellar experience that Morrowind had delivered, on a bigger scale, with better graphics and streamlined controls. Combined with the reputation of its predecessor, and Oblivion became a gigantic hit on its launch. As it turned out, the game became bigger than Bethesda had hoped for, far more successful than even Morrowind. It became the Xbox 360's fastest-selling game to date and remained one of the must-have titles for the console for years. The game sold equally well on the PC, where the modding community again created loads of new content for gamers to try out. The company was doing better now than it ever had before. Unfortunately, those same modders almost immediately ended up costing Bethesda millions of dollars. During development, the team had made a topless female model for when the players took off their clothes. However, they later decided to use a model with underwear instead. But they never actually deleted the code, they just made it inaccessible. All it took was one quick and easy mod to access it again. Unsurprisingly, a mod for topless women quickly became very popular, and it garnered enough attention for the US rating agency, the ESRB, to take notice. In the end, the ESRB chose to re-rate the game from T for teen to M for mature. They even did this to the Xbox 360 version, which couldn't be modded and thus had no nudity. This change forced Bethesda to issue a recall for every copy of their game, and then to reship all the new copies with the proper rating. While it was an unhappy affair, it didn't slow sales in the slightest.
It didn't really affect us much at all. I mean, our view is we make the game, someone else rates it. They rated it one way, and then came back later and rated it another way. You go into Fallout, you kind of know, well, this is going to be M. With the Elder Scrolls, it's personal preference on who rates it. You can go to Germany, they'll do it this way. You can go to Australia, they'll do it this way. The U.S. does it this way. So we just want to make sure they get the information, they know what the game is, and they'll make a decision.
But with the new console generation came a new way of making money. A buzzword for the HD era was downloadable content, or DLC. This would be a small bit of extra content that a gamer could buy for just a few dollars and then download straight onto his hard drive. As one of the early leaders on the 360, Oblivion would be among the first to test out what could be done with DLC. The Halo franchise had already proven that multiplayer map packs were popular, but very few had tried to produce new content for a single-player experience. So, in April 2006, just 2 weeks after the game's release, Bethesda proudly unveiled its first piece of DLC for the biggest game in their history. Horse armor. For $2.50, gamers could choose to deck their horses out in colorful armor. And that was it. No real gameplay enhancements, no new quests or adventures, just some animal clothing. Almost upon release, the Horse Armor DLC was ridiculed as a pathetic attempt to enhance the gameplay experience. Some fans even accused Bethesda of cynically trying to squeeze a few extra pennies out of their customers for practically no effort on their end. The uproar became so widespread that the term horse armor is now a byword for any DLC for any game that isn't very good. But for all that, the pretty horses were enough to convince hundreds of thousands of gamers to fork over their money. So from Bethesda's perspective, the DLC worked just fine. And they learned their lesson too. Realizing that what gamers really wanted were new quests to do and areas to explore, the later DLC sets Knights of the Nine and the Shivering Isles gave gamers exactly that. The Shivering Isles in particular featured an entirely distinct art design and tone, while also featuring a huge amount of narrative content to consume, virtually a mini sequel onto itself. So while this new business model started off rocky, it ended with the signature quality of the series. And the publishing division of the company was doing great as well. That same year, Bethesda Softworks also released a trio of Star Trek games from other developers. It was a testament to Oblivion's staggering success that even a big name like Star Trek was overshadowed by The Elder Scrolls. Further flexing its muscles, in 2007, Bethesda Softworks published Oblivion on Sony's PlayStation 3, and it did so on its own. Morrowind had been mass distributed with Ubisoft's help and Oblivion with 2K's. At last, Bethesda was ready to start distributing major releases all by itself. That was how big Oblivion had been. That being said, even Bethesda couldn't save the troubled PlayStation Portable version of Oblivion, which was meant to be a more streamlined game like the old Elder Scrolls Adventure series. Bethesda rarely mentioned the game after the initial announcement, and then stopped talking about it altogether. The game never surfaced. Despite that, Bethesda Game Studios was now clearly a AAA developer, and their owners, ZeniMax Media, decided to invest in them heavily. The developer was currently at work on a brand new Fallout game, using the license they'd gotten from Interplay. But in 2007, ZeniMax decided they didn't want to license Fallout anymore. Having full confidence that Howard and his team would craft another masterpiece, they instead bought the Fallout IP outright for $6 million. Bethesda could now do whatever they wanted with Fallout and its universe. As a part of the deal, Interplay would get a license of its own to make a Fallout MMO. Bethesda didn't know at the time just how contentious that deal would become. By the mid-2000s, Bethesda Game Studios had grown into one of the biggest RPG developers in the world. Their Elder Scrolls franchise had become famous for featuring the biggest open worlds in gaming, offering hundreds of hours of exploration, combat, narrative, and anything else players could think up. After the spectacular and studio-saving success of the third game in the series, Morrowind, Bethesda then created Oblivion, a towering commercial and critical triumph. However, after so many years of concentrating on the Elder Scrolls, for their next game, they decided to take a break and explore a different world. In 2004, Bethesda had acquired a license to make a game in the Fallout franchise from the owners of the IP, Interplay Entertainment. They began work on this franchise as soon as they finished up with Oblivion, and it quickly became clear that they were making something truly special. So much so that Bethesda's owner, ZeniMax, bought the Fallout IP outright in 2007. As part of the deal, Interplay would get a license to make a Fallout MMO. In many ways, the resulting game has defined modern Bethesda, both bringing them into the most prolonged and public conflict in their history, but also driving them to the very peak of their industry. The massively hyped Fallout 3, released in October 2008, published by Bethesda Softworks all on its own for the PC, Xbox 360, and PlayStation 3. This was only 2.5 years after their last game, Oblivion. By contrast, Oblivion had taken 4 years after Morrowind. The team this time had experience with the Xbox and PlayStation architecture, and so could push out a new game much quicker, even at the grand scale they were used to. The game itself had absolutely nothing to do with the original Fallout 3, which had been in development back at Interplay years earlier under the nickname Van Buren. Bethesda had started their project from scratch, and in doing so, put their own stamp on the series. Where older Fallouts had been top-down, third-person affairs, Fallout 3 was a first-person adventure, very much like the Elder Scrolls. Within that, however, the classic Fallout elements all returned in their full glory. The special level-up mechanic, the cartoony Pip-Boy, and the signature dry comedy all survived the journey from Interplay to Bethesda. It perfectly captured the retro 1950s sci-fi vibe that Fallout was famous for. Everything in the world reminded players of how bleak the apocalypse was, from the dreary art design to the seedy characters to the pervasive radiation. Any game that gives players the option to blow up a town with a nuke is pretty grim. It was a darker, edgier game than anything Bethesda had done before, but at the same time, it was also funnier, in a darker, edgier way. As a first-person game taking place in the future, combat revolved less around melee weapons and more around guns. This had the effect of making Fallout play more like a shooter, allowing it to appeal to a wider audience than the traditional RPG crowd. However, the massive world, great storytelling, and involving characters kept old Bethesda fans more than happy. As a matter of fact, more so than in any Elder Scrolls game, the players' actions had huge ramifications. Even trying to do the right thing could have negative consequences. In the end, depending on what players did on their journey, the ending could have any one of over 200 different permutations. Combined with veteran composer Inan Zur's haunting score, and the participation of Hollywood talent like Liam Neeson and Ron Perlman, and Fallout 3 was primed to be a smash hit on the level of Oblivion. It wasn't. It was bigger. Despite the fact that the Fallout brand had never been on consoles before and hadn't been on anything for years, Fallout 3 sold 4.7 million units in just over a week. That's $300 million in 7 days. This was by far Bethesda's biggest response to a game ever, and that spectacular beginning led to a stellar long run as well. In the end, Fallout 3 emerged as one of the best-selling RPG games of all time, and turned the studio into a juggernaut. Bethesda's attention to detail, tone, and quality had paid off, and now they reaped the rewards of their hard work. But once players finally got through the huge world and its main storyline, they discovered something shocking. Something that no one expected. An ending. Once the main quest was complete, the credits rolled, and gamers were returned to the main menu. No more exploring, no more side quests to do. Unlike the Elder Scrolls, when Fallout 3 finished, the experience was over. To put it mildly, the surprise was not well received, and broke one of the central tenets of a Bethesda experience. Besides that, the Gamebryo engine that they had been using since Morrowind was starting to show its age. Badly. Still, as with Elder Scrolls games before it, Fallout 3's overall quality outweighed these criticisms in the eyes of gamers. Meanwhile, Bethesda was hard at work on new content for the game. They would eventually release 5 pieces of DLC, none of which involved horse armor. Instead, Fallout 3's DLC packs were huge content pieces that added new areas to explore, new quests to do, new characters to meet, and hours and hours and hours of time to kill. One of them even changed the ending so that players could continue their game even after completing the main quest, fixing one of the biggest complaints players had. Taken as a whole, the DLC for Fallout 3 is often cited as some of the finest DLC ever made for a game. In other words, Bethesda's first DLC ever, Horse Armor, is still considered among the worst of all time. Their latest is considered among the best. Quite an improvement. With the windfall of cash from Fallout and its downloadable content, Bethesda's publishing arm, Bethesda Softworks, aggressively expanded. In 2009, they published both Wet and Rogue Warrior, though, sadly, neither game was well received. Rogue Warrior in particular took a bruising from the press. But in June of that year, Bethesda announced a surprise, and it was a whopper. Their owners, ZeniMax Media, acquired no less than id Software itself. Id was the legendary studio behind the birth of the first-person shooter genre, whose Doom and Quake games had redefined the industry in the 90s. Like ZeniMax itself, they had remained fiercely independent for years, refusing offers of acquisition from major powers like Activision. However, by the late 2000s, Id realized that they simply didn't have the manpower or resources to remain competitive on their own. Their last game had released in 2004, and even though Doom 3 was a smash hit, they needed more capital to make more games. ZeniMax promised to give them total creative freedom, something they proved with their Bethesda team. And so, Id agreed to join the Bethesda family. Not long after, Bethesda also bought the distribution rights to Id's current project, Rage. From now on, anything id will be released by Bethesda, including id's older classics, which Bethesda recently brought to Xbox Live Arcade and the PlayStation Network. In addition, Bethesda now uses id's annual QuakeCon event to showcase all the upcoming games that it will publish, whether from Bethesda, id, or an external party. But after this good news, came the bad. In September 2009, Bethesda filed a lawsuit against former Fallout owners Interplay. When Bethesda had bought the franchise from them, they had given Interplay a license to make a Fallout MMO, provided they raised the money themselves and began work within 2 years. The 2 years were up, and Bethesda wanted Interplay to stop trying to raise money. Interplay resisted, claiming that they were indeed working on the game and that Bethesda was out of line. This feud is ongoing to this day, and has only gotten more heated as time has gone on. Bethesda now claims that when they gave Interplay a license to make a Fallout MMO, they only meant an MMO named Fallout. In other words, Interplay cannot use any assets, weapons, characters, or locations from Fallout. They can't even use the logo. Interplay, of course, contests this and in fact claims that since Bethesda is breaching the terms of the contract, the rights to Fallout should revert back to them. It's an all-around ugly affair with no end in sight. Appropriately for Fallout, it's a dark questline where consequences of previous decisions have come to haunt both parties. None of this stopped Bethesda from publishing a new Fallout game in 2010. New Vegas was not made by the game studio's division, but rather by outside developer Obsidian Entertainment. This was no coincidence. Obsidian had been founded by the former Interplay team that had created Fallout in the first place. Bethesda now allowed them to tell the tale that Interplay had not. New Vegas used the same engine and style as Fallout 3 had. The setting had changed from a destroyed Washington, D.C. to the destroyed American West, allowing for a welcome change to the color tones and art. In fact, Fallout New Vegas showcased the exact same setting they had been working on in the canceled Van Buren project years earlier. While the world and story were still as huge and involving as fans had come to expect, the graphics were really getting decrepit at this point. And at its launch, the game was as buggy as, well, a Bethesda title. Still, New Vegas went on to be a success on the level of the massive Fallout 3. 2011 saw Bethesda publishing more external titles, the shooter Brink from developer Splash Damage, and the RPG Hunted the Demon's Forge from developer In Exile. Unfortunately, neither game scored well with the critics. To date, Bethesda has yet to successfully launch a franchise that they didn't have a hand in internally. But they'll get their chance in October when they at last release id Software's long-awaited Rage.
With a mix of RPG, driver, and classic shooter elements, the game will show off the latest id Tech engine and hopes to remind gamers everywhere why id once ruled the gaming world. Still, being a first-person shooter set in a post-apocalyptic desert, Rage may find itself competing with Bethesda's own Fallout franchise. Of course, it's possible that the success of Fallout may actually lift gamer interest in that genre. Aside from Rage, Bethesda currently has a whole suite of games to publish, including no less than Elder Scrolls V from Todd Howard and the Bethesda Game Studios team. Bethesda is taking this opportunity to address many of the issues gamers had with the series, starting with the graphics. Finally tossing the old Gamebryo engine, Bethesda has built their own homebrew engine for the first time since 1995. This new creation engine seeks to improve facial animations and draw distances, while still giving a quality polish to every detail. Using this new tool, Bethesda is once again handcrafting the entire world. No randomly generated environments. Everything will be made with an artist's touch. Also, the game promises to have dragon battles. The game, titled Skyrim, is set to release worldwide on November 11th, 2011. This is notable because this is the same week that the juggernaut franchise Call of Duty will release its newest title. Such is the Elder Scrolls reputation that even the biggest name in gaming doesn't scare Bethesda away. Down the road, Bethesda also plans to publish Dishonored from developer Arkane Studios, which they acquired in 2010, and Prey 2, an IP they bought in 2009 from developer Human Head Studios. In addition, id founder John Carmack has stated that they are already at work on Doom 4. However, in the meantime, Bethesda have embroiled themselves in another legal battle, this time with indie developer Mojang. Famous for creating the underground sensation Minecraft, Mojang has scheduled its next game, Scrolls, to release on November 11th, 2011, the same day as the Elder Scrolls. Bethesda filed a lawsuit claiming the similar titles and dates would create market confusion. Mojang protests, stating that Bethesda cannot possibly have a trademark on the word Scrolls. Mojang has offered to settle the matter over a game of Quake. Although since Bethesda owns Quakemaker's id Software, it probably wouldn't be a fair fight. The case is ongoing. Bethesda Game Studios stands as one of the most powerful developers in the world, with an ardent fan base and a sterling track record. With the growing might of their publishing division, Bethesda Softworks, they stand poised to become one of the industry's biggest players. And most amazingly, their owners, ZeniMax Media, have remained private through all this time. They don't have to worry about placating investors or about how a decision might affect stock. ZeniMax and the studios they own can do whatever they want.
The fact that we were private and published our own stuff and got to make crazy games, and we still get to do that now, it's just on a larger scale, is kind of, I think it's really, really rare. Everybody's very, very self-motivated to do the game they would want to play. And even from those days, we're really fortunate that we are a private company who publishes our own games. But we have the ability to publish up against anybody. And we can put our game worldwide, as many copies as we need. So creatively, we get to do what we want.
In June 2011, Bethesda celebrated their 25th anniversary, better able to make the games they love than ever before. They are starting to experience the growing pains of reaching the big leagues, including the trials of publishing and the backlash of legal suits. But it seems clear that 25 years on, Bethesda's world still has endless hours of content left to explore.